Today we will discuss some concentration inequalities. These concentration inequalities, it's a very vast topic. We will only discuss some very elementary inequalities. Basically, what these concentration inequalities say is that they give you certain probability bounds on random variables taking atypical values. Okay, so that is roughly the plain English level. That's what it is. So if you're talking about, let's say, a random variable with a certain mean and a certain variance. For example, one of the inequalities we will do will say that the probability of a random variable taking values outside a certain range of the mean is very small. Okay, so those, so essentially, it's called concentration because the probability concentrates around a certain range, right? So, on these kind of inequalities are called concentration inequalities. It's a very vast topic. Okay, so we will only do some very elementary ones. Okay. So the most important one is called Markov's inequality. This says that if X is a non-negative random variable, then so here you are looking at a non-negative random variable and some alpha greater than 0, and this is Markov's inequality. This says that the probability that X takes values larger than alpha is at most expectation of X over alpha. Okay, so this should be greater than alpha. Okay, X greater than alpha is less than or equal to expectation of X over alpha. Okay. So this is meaningful. So this is always true, okay, for any non-negative random variable, but this is meaningful obviously only when expectation of X is less than alpha, right? For only for values alpha bigger than expectation of X is this even meaningful. If not, you will get something here that's bigger than 1, and then you're just saying that the probability is less than 1, right? That is completely trivial. But if you're so let me say useful for alpha bigger than expectation of X. So it just says that this is a very weak kind of an inequality, but it's a very universal inequality for non-negative random variables. So if you're considering a value that's bigger than the expectation, so it says that the probability of the random variable becoming larger than that alpha is less than or equal to expectation of X over alpha. It goes down as 1 over alpha, okay. Goes down at least as fast as 1 over alpha, okay. So, for example, the probability of a random non-negative random variable taking value greater than twice its expectation is at most half, right. That is the kind of result this is. So the proof is very elementary. So you have expectation of X is equal to, you can write it like this, right? You can you can write it as expectation of x indicator x less than or equal to alpha plus expectation of x times the indicator of x greater than alpha, correct? That is because I have skipped a step. So, this indicator and that indicator have to add to 1, right? So, and I am using linearity of expectations. So, this indicator, so this indicator fires only when x is less than or equal to alpha, right. So, when this indicator fires, this x is less than or equal to alpha, right. So, this means that this is less than or equal to alpha plus is that right? So, expectation of this indicator actually, you know what? No, 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 that is not what I want to do. I apologize. This is not true, right. So, what I want to do is to say that actually, I want to bound it this way, is it not? So, I have to say that this is greater than or equal to. So, this guy is actually non-negative, is not it? That bit is non-negative, because x is a non-negative random variable. Yeah. So, this is non-negative. Yeah. So, I want to go this way. After all, I want expectation greater than or equal to something, right. So, I want the inequality to go this way. So, I get this is greater than or equal to expectation of x times indicator x bigger than alpha that is greater than or equal to or is rather greater than or so wait a second. So, this is greater than or equal to actually alpha times the expectation of the indicator of x bigger than alpha. Right? You agree with that? Because I know that this indicator will fire only if x is bigger than alpha. So, if I put alpha here, right? So, I will get something that is smaller, right? And I can bring that out. And this is nothing but alpha times the probability of this expectation of indicator is fine. It is actually fairly elementary, right. So, I messed up this inequality in the beginning. So, this is just 3 steps. Okay. So, this is Markov inequality. So, this Markov inequality is often very loose. Okay. So, this only says that the probability of x becoming very large, some very large value alpha goes down like 1 over alpha, right. So, by the way, this is for non-negative random variable with expectation of x finite. Okay. Often, so this 1 over alpha decay of this probability is often a very conservative estimate. Okay. Often, this probability goes down much quicker, but Markov inequality is very weak. It only gives you that. So, if you want to look at the probability of x becoming larger than 10 times its mean, you only say it is like roughly like 1 over 10, right. It is a very often it decays much quicker for commonly encountered distributions. Okay. So, although this is the most simplest inequality, concentration inequality, you can strengthen these kind of probabilities if you assume further, if you make further assumptions. Okay. For example, when you assume a finite variance, you get a quicker decay that goes like the squared. Okay. That is the next thing I will do. is Chebyshev's inequality. This Chebyshev is spelt in very different ways. I believe it's pronounced Chebyshev, and it's pronounced with a T, Z, and so on, right? There are several spellings of this. I don't know what the correct spelling is. Okay, I believe it's pronounced like Chebyshev. If X is a random variable with mean mu and variance sigma squared, so this is all finite, then probability of so, this is Chebyshev's inequality. So, now you are taking a random variable with mean mu. This random variable need not be non-negative, okay. It is any random variable, but it must have finite variance. Okay. Finite variance implies finite mean. So, mu and sigma are both finite. Okay. This is mean, this is variance. Now, we are saying that this Chebyshev's inequality says that the probability, so you are looking at the absolute value of the difference between x and the mean, right. So, what is the probability that the random variable exceeds the mean in absolute value by k times the standard deviation, right. And we are saying that goes down like 1 by k squared, 1 upon k squared. Okay. So, it will just give you a picture. Generally, you are considering some random variable. This is, let's say, for the sake of argument, say this has some density. Okay, doesn't have to, but let's say your mean is somewhere here, and let's say your standard deviation is about that much. Okay, so we are saying that the probability of the random variable, let's say this is k sigma, this is mu, this is mu plus k sigma, all right, and this is mu minus k sigma, right. So, let me say that is k sigma. Okay. So, you are saying that the difference, the probability of random variable taking values outside k times the standard deviation from the mean goes down like 1 over k squared. Okay. So, again, you can say probability of x minus mu greater than c is less than or equal to sigma squared over c squared, is not it? This is for c greater than 0. This is another way of saying it. So, you have the probability of x minus mu exceeding c is at most sigma squared over c squared, right. You put c equal to k sigma, you will get this back. So, again, so recall that the sigma represents how widely spread the random variable is, right. So, this bound will be fairly small if your sigma is small, right. But in any case, the important thing is it goes down like the squared of what you are considering the deviation c or the k, right. So, the proof is very simple. What you do is you apply Markov inequality to the non-negative random variable absolute value of x minus mu squared. Okay. So, in that case, what will you have? You will have probability of, so the x minus mu squared is obviously a non-negative random variable. You are looking at the probability that it requires, it exceeds k squared sigma squared, which is obviously less than or equal to expectation of x minus mu squared over k squared sigma squared, right. But that is nothing but sigma squared. What is on the top is sigma squared, right. So, that is equal to 1 over k squared. Okay. So, Markov inequality tells you, it only assumes finite mean, it tells you a 1 over alpha kind of a decay. Chebyshev's inequality assumes a finite variance, it gives you 1 over k squared kind of a decay, right. So, a little bit tighter in that sense, but you need finite variance. Actually, even Chebyshev's inequality often turns out to be quite loose. Okay. For example, if you have a random variable which is, let us say, exponentially distributed, you know that probability of x greater than, let us say, probability of x greater than alpha goes down like e power minus mu alpha, right. Right. So, that is exponentially fast, right. So, even this 1 over k square kind of estimate is not a very good estimate, right, because here you are using only variance information, there you are using only mean, here you are using mean and variance. So, if you have, so you can often tighten these kind of inequalities if you make further assumptions. So, if you assume that the third moment is finite, you can get some k cubed, or if you assume fourth moment is finite, you can get 1 over k to the 4 and so on, right. That is not a big deal. So, finally, if you assume, so I mean taking this to even further, if you assume that the moment generating function of the random variable x is finite in some neighborhood of the origin, then you can get some exponentially decaying concentration bounds, okay. Because after all, see the moment generating function is expectation of e power s x, right. And if you are saying that this is finite for some in some neighborhood of the origin, then you are saying that some exponential moment exists, right, which means you can get exponentially decaying concentration bounds for such random variables, right. In fact, I will not spend too much time on this. This is such an inequality does exist. It is a very important inequality called Chernoff bound. Okay, have you heard of it? Chernoff bound. So, I will just briefly indicate what it is, but I will not spend too much time on it, okay, because we have to move on to limit theorems and so on. So, Chernoff bound is very useful, because it gives you as exponential estimates. Okay. So, let us say assume that m x of s, which is nothing but expectation of e power s x, is finite for s belonging to minus minus epsilon some interval around the origin. Okay. Then you can say that let us say you are looking for the probability of x becoming bigger than some alpha. Okay. Same kind of a similar to this, okay. But so this you can write as probability of e power s x bigger than e power S alpha, is not it, for S bigger than 0. If my S is bigger than 0, I certainly have. So, this will be a monotonically increasing function, right. So, e power S x. So, x bigger than alpha is same as e power S x bigger than e power S alpha. S alpha, is that right? S x, S, yeah, that is right, fine, agreed. Now, for S, so S is bigger than 0 and e power S x is a non-negative random variable, right. So, I can apply Markov inequality. So, you see, you keep going back to Markov inequality. It is a very weak inequality, but it kind of forms the foundation of so many other inequalities. Okay. So, you have, so by Markov inequality, we have that probability of x bigger than alpha is less than or equal to m x of s, right. This is m x of s. So, the expectation of e power s x divided by e power this guy, right. So, this you will agree, right. This is valid for all s such that s is bigger than 0, and of course, this guy must be finite, right. So, you have assumed that it is finite for some s belonging to minus epsilon epsilon, but this may not be the domain of convergence, right. So, this is valid for s bigger than 0 and s belongs to domain of convergence d x, right. That is what we denoted, right, the domain of convergence. So, well and good. So, and this is true for, so this is true for all s bigger than 0 and all s in the domain of convergence. So, this is already an exponential bound if you notice. Right, s is bigger than 0. So, this is something that decays exponentially in alpha, correct. So, this is a much tighter estimate. Now, so you have freedom to choose s, correct. So, what kind of s will you choose? So, you have to choose the S that infimizes this whole thing, right. So, you can say that, so this is again less than or equal to infimum S positive, and of course, S has to be in the domain of convergence, infimum all this m x of S e power minus S alpha. Okay. Now, sometimes people use the log moment generating function. So, people write m x of s as e power, is like the, you take the log of this guy, call it the log moment generating function. Let us say, so you define let lambda x of s equal to log m x of s wherever it is defined. And then, so you can write this as e power minus let me do this properly, S alpha minus lambda x of S sup, right, sup, this becomes sup here, is not it, when I take it up, sup S bigger than 0, right. Because there is a negative sign, it becomes a sup. So, that is your Markov inequality for s bigger than 0. Similarly, you can, sorry, not Markov inequality, Chernoff bound for s bigger than 0. For s less than 0, you will get a similar bound for probability that x less than alpha, right. If s is less than 0, so probability x less than alpha will be equal to the same thing if s is less than 0, right. So, you will get, a similar exponential estimate on the negative side of on the this tail, what is what you call this, the left side tail, right. This is a, so if you are looking at some random variable whose, let us say for the sake of argument, let us say it has some PDF like that. Actually, let me, yeah. So, if you are looking at the, okay. So, if you have some random variable like that, so this is giving you the probability that x is bigger than alpha, right. You can also get the probability of x less than alpha, right, by if you take the similar s less than 0, right. So, if this is your density, you do not actually need the density, you just need the moment generating function to exist, right. And this kind of a calculation, so this kind of calculation forms the foundation of what is known as the theory of large deviations, okay. Getting these exponential bounds. So, this, if at all you pick up, if you study large deviations, this is what you will get, you will encounter this expression a lot, okay. It has lots of nice properties. This lambda x is a convex function, you can show, and this is called the convex dual of the log moment generating function and so on. So, it has lots of nice properties, okay, but that is really taking us too far afield, okay. All you need to know is that you can get exponentially decaying bounds on this kind of a probability, okay. Any questions? Yeah, so after you supremize over S, what remains will only be a function of alpha, right. So, that will look something like, so this will look like, so you can e power minus for some other function lambda star, it look like e power minus lambda star of alpha, right. So, I am just calling this after you supremize this function as the lambda star, okay. So, this is a very typical large deviation bound, okay. Similarly, you can do a calculation for s less than 0 for the left side tail. Okay, any questions? Yeah, if you are interested in this kind of stuff, you can first look up Wikipedia or some textbook on Chernoff bound, and large deviations theory is basically takes off from here, okay. Are there any questions? Yes.
For continuous random variables, whether mean value divides PDF into two sections with a half probability?
No.
No.
So that is called median, right? For any random variable, so the point where you have half the probability on the side, half the probability on the side is called the median. Okay, so that I think that concludes this little bit of a small section on concentration inequalities. So that brings us to the final module or final section in this course. This is about convergence of random variables and limit theorems, okay, and it is probably the most technically challenging part of this course, okay. So, this requires a lot of effort, this what I am going to talk about, convergence of random variables. Because there is, we will discuss convergence of random variables and various notions of convergence of random variables and we will also say how these notions of convergence are related and so on. So, what my experience has been that students often struggle with this. Okay, it's a little bit difficult to digest and get it into your heads, but once you understand it, it's all, it's just fine. So, you have to, what you have to do, I'm saying this because this, you know, this is getting to the end of semester, right, but this is a time when you have to really put in some thought and effort and study, you know, so this this convergence of random variables. Okay, it's a somewhat of a challenging section. Okay, not easy when you're seeing it for the first time. So, if you are given a sequence of real numbers x1 through x1, x2 dot dot dot, we know what it means, what it means for x to converge, right. It just means that when n gets large, xn, so if x is your limit, absolute value of xn minus x can be made less than epsilon, right, for any epsilon for large enough n. Now, we are going to talk about convergence of random variables, a sequence of random variables. Okay. So, as usual, so you have some probability space omega fp, probability space, and x1 x2 dot 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 be a sequence of random variables on this space. So, if you want to speak about the convergence of a sequence of random variables, see, random variables are what kind of objects? They are functions, right. So, it is, you are essentially talking about convergence of functions, right. So, this is something we have already defined, come to think of it, right, when we did MCT and so on, we talked about convergence of random variables, pointwise convergence of random variables, and what is it we talk about? Almost sure convergence of random variables, right. So, those two things we will, I will repeat, okay, and then I will also give you a few other notions of convergence, okay, which are commonly encountered. Okay, then we will talk about, so about 4 or 5 different convergence notions we will define, and we will talk about how they are related. Okay. So, this you already know, definition 0. The sequence xi, this, the sequence is said to converge pointwise or surely to x if xn of omega converges to x of omega for all omega in the sample space as n tends to infinity. So, this is something we have already seen, right. This is like pointwise convergence of functions. You pick any omega in the sample space, for that omega you have a sequence of real numbers x1 of omega, x2 of omega dot dot dot, right. For as soon as omega realizes, the sequence of random variables becomes a sequence of real numbers. Now, we know what it means to talk about the sequence of real numbers, right. So, now this sequence of real numbers x n of omega converges to some x of omega, right, and that is your, that, so, and if that happens for every omega in the sample space, this is called pointwise convergence or sure convergence, right, for every omega you have this convergence. Okay. Is that clear? This is exactly point wise convergence of functions, right. So, often, but often we know that, so this is too strict a notion of convergence, all right. That is because in probability we do not often, we are willing to sacrifice measure 0 sets as such, probability measure 0 sets, right. So, we do not really care about probability measure 0 sets. So, we will slightly weaken this definition to say that we will, so x n converges to x almost surely if this convergence happens except probably on a set of measure 0, probability 0. Okay. This I think we, this also we did, right. We call it almost everywhere convergence, I guess, mu almost everywhere convergence. Now, the mu is this probability measure definition 1. So, I call this definition 0 because in probability you never use this. Sure convergence is too strong a notion of convergence to be useful in probability. Okay. Definition 1. So, we say, so I am not going to write the whole thing again, right. We say x n converges to x almost surely or with probability 1 if x n of omega converges to x of omega on a set of probability 1, i.e. probability of omega for which x n of omega converges to x of omega equal to 1. Okay. The set of all omegas, so this says that this convergence happens not necessarily for all omega in sample space, but on a set of probability 1. So, there may be some little omegas left out where the convergence does not happen, but they have probability 0. Okay. That is almost sure convergence. Okay. Sometimes this is also called strong convergence. Now, there is a little bit of technicalities here, one has to be a little bit careful. So, one has to prove that this kind of an event, this kind of whatever is inside the probability here, right, you are looking at the event omega that x n of omega converges to x of omega, right. You have to prove that such a subset of omegas is indeed an event, right, but that can be done. Okay. So, otherwise you cannot speak of its probability, right. So the way you prove that is, so you assume that the limiting random variable is 0, or you can consider simply absolute value of x n minus x, right, and then the limiting random variable will be 0. So, if you consider this as the 0 random variable, you can actually write out this event as a countable unions and intersections of f measurables, the events. Okay. Maybe I will put this, maybe we should put this in the homework, okay, to show that the set is indeed indeed an event. So, is this clear? And of course, there is also one other technicality we left out. I think this also can be proven that if x n of, so the limit of a sequence of measurable functions or random variables is always a measurable function. So, also I mentioned earlier the proof is not all that difficult, again you have to write the sets of the form x, so x greater than alpha in terms of unions and intersections of these guys, right. These are technicalities, I did not really emphasize these too much, but they can be done. So, the limit of a sequence of random variables is always a random variable, okay. It is always an f measurable function, and these kind of events are indeed events, are f measurable. Okay. Any questions on this? So the way I will do this is I will give you all the definitions in one shot. Hopefully you will digest it abstractly, and then we will give examples, okay, to illustrate the difference between the various notions of convergence. Okay. Any questions on this? Definition 2. So now we are talking about the notion of convergence in probability. Okay. Say x n converges to x in probability if for all epsilon greater than 0. The limit of the probability that x n greater than x, so x n minus x greater than epsilon is 0. Okay. So if you are looking at, if you are looking at the difference between x n and x, absolute value of the difference between x n and x, and you are looking at the probability that the difference exceeds epsilon. Okay. Epsilon is something very small, let us say. You are fixing some epsilon very small. And you are saying, looking at the probability that the absolute value of the difference between x n and x exceeds epsilon. And if for every epsilon greater than 0, if this limit goes to 0, then you say x n converges to x in probability. Okay. So, so convergence in probability is very different from convergence with probability 1. Okay, it may not be totally apparent to you now that they are in fact very different, okay. But convergence with probability, so one thing, the limit is inside the probability, right. We are looking at the probability of omega for which x n of limit x n is equal to x. Here the limit is outside the probability, right. You can write this whole thing as probability of omega for which limit x n equals x, right. Another way of writing this is probability of omega for which limit x n is equal to x. Here the probability is inside the probability is outside the limit, here the limit is outside the probability, right. So they are actually not the same. Okay. So that is why it gets a little tricky. You have to digest these notions very carefully, understand what it means. See the one thing, see this is a bit of a misnomer, okay. See there are only, see the sure convergence, almost sure convergence, in these two cases you have the sequence of random variables themselves converging, okay. Here it is a bit of a misnomer to say x n converges to x in probability. After all, what is, it is not like x n, the sequence x n itself converges to x here, it is just that some sequence of probabilities are converging to 0. Okay, so rather than, so this has become standard terminology, but a correct terminology would be to say that rather than say a sequence convergence in probability, you can say that the sequence of probabilities converges, this sequence of probabilities converges, right. So here I am saying that the sequence itself converges to x of omega. Here it is not true that, it is not necessarily the case that x n itself converges to x. This may not happen. It is only that this probability sequence goes to 0. If you call this P n or something, if you call this guy, let us say P n of epsilon, let us say, I can call this P n of epsilon, right. So the sequence P n of epsilon goes to 0, that is all. It is not like x n goes to x in any, in any real sense. Okay. I guess what I am trying to say is that in here, over here, when you pick a very large n, x n of omega itself becomes very close to x of omega, right. The difference between x n of omega and x n x of omega becomes very small for almost all omega, right, not all omega, but the x n of omega itself gets close to x of omega. Here that is not necessarily the case, right. What this is saying is that this probability goes to 0, right. There may be sets of probability greater than 0, where x n of omega and x of omega need not be close, but this overall probability goes to 0 of deviation by more than epsilon goes to 0. Okay. Again, this is not something that is so apparent to you at this point, right, which is why I am saying these notions are a little subtle. What we will show is that convergence with probability 1 or convergence almost surely will imply convergence in probability, but convergence in probability does not imply convergence almost surely. Okay. So, this implies this, but this does not imply that. So, this is a strictly stronger notion of convergence than this. Okay. Okay, so I will stop here. I will continue with couple of more definitions, and then we will see how these convergence notions are related to each other. Okay.